In the early hours of January the 20th, 1996, a number of UFOs were reported in the skies above central Brazil. Some of them were captured on home video. Then, in a bizarre twist, reports started emerging that one of these UFOs had actually crashed near the town of Varginha, and that the local military had recovered some alien bodies. For many in the UFO community, this was the most significant event since the Roswell crash of 1947.
We know we have a lot of evidence here, and there is a huge cover-up in Brazil since January 1996. I do believe we were visited by alien creatures who were captured by the militaries, and I want to know what happened to these creatures. I think the whole world wants to know if these creatures are still in Brazil, and definitely what happened to them.
It's just unbelievably undeniable. Undeniable. It doesn't matter what the military say, they are hiding. They are hiding. They do have captured aliens in Brazil alive.
According to eyewitness reports, the UFO crashed on the edge of Varginha, a small industrial town in the heart of Brazil.
Well, about 2 a.m. in the morning of the January 20th, some satellites from the United States detected an object entering Earth's atmosphere. Of course, it was aiming to Brazil, and they let us know, the American authorities, or American military, let Brazilian authorities know that it was aiming to Brazil, so we should keep an eye on it. Well, while this object was falling down, it was observed by a few witnesses. It was very strange because some of them could describe an object like a cigar-shaped, with a cigar-shaped format, like in flame, with some sparkles, things like that. Anyway, at this same morning, about 7:30, some people in the neighboring areas of Varginha started describing a strange creature. Obviously, the creature that survived from the crash.
In January the 20th, the fire department captured a creature, a very strange creature. They wrapped this creature in a net and put inside this square meters wood box and gave it straight to the militaries who went there to pick it up. They said it was a terrible smell of ammonia, burning the noses, they couldn't breathe, and it was a very ugly creature. One of them told me that he would like to see me in a room for 1 minute facing such a creature like that, because it was so ugly. And it had 3 fingers with long and very strong nails. One of the creatures in the military facility scratched one of the tables, wood table. You should see what happened to the table when one of the creatures just scratched it. Well, when they first understood what was going on, they got really astonished, because all of a sudden, Brazilian militaries were right in front of an alien being. They just got so surprised, because they never thought an alien being could be like that. They were really astonished, and they were afraid of getting some disease from it.
Thank you.
The description of the bodies connected with the Virginia case makes it sound much more like they were cargo than crew. They seem to be woozy. They didn't have any clothes, the little horns, the color of the skin and stuff. Their reactions did not imply particularly high intelligence. Now, who knows? Maybe this was a crew from a different place, and we don't know what their mental capabilities were or something like that. But you just don't get the feeling, looking at the drawings that have been made, the testimony of the witnesses, that we're dealing with particularly sophisticated aliens here. And I can imagine a cargo craft that ran into some kind of a problem. Pilot error is common, apparently, in which these guys were set loose and weren't really the operators of the craft.
Clearly something unusual happened, but there are a number of alternatives which do first need to be explored. One possibility is that we need to look at the likelihood that we had some sort of satellite re-entry, space debris coming into the Earth's atmosphere at high level. Clearly, we do have some indication that NORAD passed a warning to the Brazilian national authorities that there was indeed some high-level event taking place. So that is the first thing that I think UFO researchers and others need to consider here. Any time that you have accounts, particularly if there are of sightings late at night, of bright lights seen very close above the ground, a lot of activity going on, what you may be dealing with is the military carrying out some sort of night maneuvers. Now, you can have military trucks, obviously brightly illuminated with headlights and all sorts of other freestanding lights, for example. You could even have a low-flying helicopter actually hovering very close to the ground or actually indeed on the ground. And in some meteorological conditions, and I'm talking about the wind here, you need not necessarily hear a great deal of noise until you get very close to it.
According to reports, a combined team of army and firemen removed something or someone from the crash wreckage and then took them to the local hospital.
The reaction of the doctors and the nurses was kind of mixed up because some of them thought it could be an alien creature. Others thought it could be some genetic experiment, and some of them thought it could be the devil's son.
The military, some of them who actually took part in the capture proceedings, came to the researchers to tell, I was part of it. I was there. I helped to capture. I helped to hold. I helped to put in the box. I helped to transport. See, we have first-hand witnesses from the military.
Corpo de Bombeiros, boa tarde.
The local fire station confirmed that they were called out to an incident on January the 20th, but their commander denied that any UFOs or aliens were involved.
Quase que eu sou muito, eu não tenho condições de falar. Primeiro que eu estava de serviço no dia, certo? Quem estava de serviço no dia é o sargento chefiando a equipe, né? Mas que pela informação aí que a gente tem, tanto faz como a imprensa, né, como até o pessoal perito na área de ufologia, é a mesma que eu tenho, que eles têm, né? Mas simplesmente não tá, se trata só do nosso ver, de falta assim, de prova material, se trata só de boatos. Então o boato para a gente não é lógico, então a gente tem que ver. Com força até profissional, nós não convivemos com boatos, mas porém com a lógica. É só com a lógica que nós somos. Então, se nós não tivermos condições de mostrar para o povo e não capturamos nada, então aí nós fomos centro da atenção porque a pessoa, em geral, pensa que o bombeiro tinha material para transportar, como vocês viram aí, né? É, foi testemunha nosso recurso para capturar um ser extraterrestre com inteligência extraterrestre. É muito escasso. Então, nós tivemos só um período, né? Um período que foi o máximo, né? O pessoal procurou divulgar, procurar com a gente respostas que a gente não tinha, né? Coisas que é difícil. Então, foi muito interesse que tiveram, porque é uma curiosidade. Nós, povo brasileiro, nós precisamos de heróis e de fato novo. E surgiu um boato que é um fato novo. Como foi o chupacabra, né? Que foi comédia e até hoje. Certo?
Why do people say that the fire brigade captured an alien on that day?
Porque a gente aqui em Varginha, nel mondo, dizem que os bombeiros hanno capturado estas estranhas criaturas em 6 de janeiro de 1996.
Eu acho que é simplesmente para subverter, ter a cidade como uma atração, que foi uma atração mundial, divulgada no mundo inteiro, até serviu de parte contra da televisão. E é uma forma de mostrar a cidade de Varginha para o mundo, criando uma ideia fantasiosa a respeito desse fato.
When asked permission to interview the actual fireman who allegedly captured these aliens on the day, the commander says that they were on leave.
Some of the gentlemen who performed the capture came to us and gave a report of what's going on. Now, it's not second-hand report. Those reports came from people who actually helped to capture, to hold the creatures. So this is the best report someone can have. I wish the Americans have a report of someone holding the Roswell creatures back 50 years ago. They don't, but we do about Varginha.
One of the witnesses who came forward was a soldier who claimed to have escorted this creature to the hospital. This is a recording of a telephone interview.
Foi simplesmente inacreditável, eu não conseguia acreditar no que os meus olhos estavam a ver. Eles trouxeram uma criatura no extraterrestre, numa maca. É estranho, foi simplesmente inacreditável, sério. Eu fazia parte da equipa que foi enviada para guardar o laboratório onde os cientistas estudavam a criatura. Não sei se dizer se estava vivo ou morto, era muito estranho. O nosso comandante estava com medo que apanhássemos alguma doença daquela coisa. O cheiro era horrível, parece mesmo como se tivessem urinado. A criatura tinha mais ou menos 1 metro de altura, a pele era castanha, oleosa e brilhante. Aqueles olhos vermelhos, os olhos eram incríveis, enormes. Tinha uma garra esquisita de pulmão. Quer dizer, de maneira nenhuma aquilo podia ser humano. Era definitivamente algo extraterrestre. Estive apenas envolvido nisto no hospital. Enquanto aguardava o laboratório, a equipa médica fazia todo o tipo de testes na criatura. Que era autópsia, se estavam a tentar salvar a vida da criatura. Posso dizer que a equipa médica estava tão nervosa e chocada quanto eu. Basta imaginar o quão estranho isto foi, sério, inacreditável. No final, os médicos confirmaram que a criatura, entretanto, morreu. Sério, toda esta experiência foi a coisa mais doida que eu já vi. Sei que parece loucura, mas eu estive lá. Aconteceu de verdade e vi aquela criatura com os meus olhos.
Pessoas de Varginha, no sul de Minas, juram que viram um ser muito estranho. Nem homem.
As dawn broke on January the 20th, Varginha found itself in the center of a UFO maelstrom.
Muita gente acredita que trata-se de um extraterrestre. E dizem também que o ser foi capturado pelas autoridades e é mantido escondido em algum lugar.
The town was just going insane because everybody was on the streets because many UFOs were sighted at that time. So people was just connecting one thing to another. I'm talking about hundreds, thousands of people on the streets, and everybody wanted to know, demanding answers. It was a kind of a mass hysteria, I can tell you this.
In fact, there were hundreds of reports of UFOs in the skies above Brazil, flooding into the authorities.
Surge uma novidade importante no caso do extraterrestre que teria aparecido em Varginha, sul de Minas.
Uma testemunha militar afirma que a criatura foi mesmo capturada com vida.
O Fantástico teve acesso às declarações secretas desse militar. Segundo os pesquisadores que acompanham o caso Varginha, ele sabe o que está dizendo.
Mas os pesquisadores acreditam que a grande evidência do caso Varginha é o depoimento de militares que teriam participado das operações de captura e retirada da cidade do suposto ET.
The local military base which was involved in this incident was an officer training academy called ESA. When asked about the UFO crash and alien capture, they flatly denied it. But bizarrely, they explained the eyewitness reports of aliens at the hospital as a misidentified dwarf couple.
Porque na realidade, aparições de extraterrestres ou de OVNIs, isso não houve porque não houve uma comprovação. O que ocorreu mesmo foi o seguinte: no dia 20 de janeiro, estava chovendo muito, muito forte em Varginha, correu um temporal. Esses caminhões Mercedes-Benz, que eles estavam indo na garantia. Então nós deslocamos dois caminhões até Varginha para que fizesse a manutenção prevista. Tudo disso aí, no desenrolar de toda a história, houve uma série de coincidências de fatos. Havia no hospital de Varginha um casal de anões, onde a senhora estava grávida para ganhar um neném. Tudo ter colocado no caminhão e levado para o hospital de Varginha, onde o pessoal disse ter encontrado um casal de ETs, que na realidade eram um casal de anões, estavam lá e essas meninas estavam para ter filho.
I understand that some of the Brazilian military authorities have said that the whole incident may stem from a bizarre misidentification of an actually a real case which actually involved a dwarf couple being taken, I think, to hospital. Now, I don't know about that myself, but I mean, speaking from my own experience of the military, they are an honourable group of people, and if they say that this took place and that this is the explanation, I think we clearly have to put some store by that.
It's possible that a second alien creature may have escaped this crash, because several hours after the alleged death of the first alien in the hospital, a second alien creature was spotted hiding in waste ground on the edge of town.
Estava vindo serviço e resolvemos passar por ali, que é caminho de casa, né? A gente mora no Santana, então era trajeto. E passamos por ali para ir embora para casa no trio, né?
A gente viu uma criatura estranha que no momento que a gente passou, não olhava pra gente, não. E quando a Kátia gritou, aí que ela olhou pra gente.
We asked the girls to tell us what the creature looked like. With the help of an artist, we built up a detailed sketch.
Marrom. A pele dele parecia ser muito mole. Porque o sol tava batendo nele, tava iluminando, parecia ser muito mole, tipo no coração, uma coisa assim. Os olhos vermelhos arregalados, as três perseveranças na cabeça, veia sobre o ombro. Quando ela olhou pra gente assim, ela passou que tava se sofrendo, que tava ansiosa, que tava com alguma dor. Não, assim, foi na hora que eu olhei assim, que eu fixei meus olhos na criatura, foi o jeito, assim, parecia que tava sofrendo. O jeito que ela olhou pra mim.
A Kátia e a Liliane saiu correndo. Eu fiquei parada. Aí elas voltaram, me pegou, eu correndo e fomos embora.
They saw what looked like a devil. That comes the story. Because this creature had three things in the head that resembled like horns, but weren't horns at all. And it had a brown skin, a brown, like a grease oil all over, and the veins, black, purple veins, were very visible on the upper arm and the neck.
The three sisters' description of the creature they saw was remarkably similar to the one given by the soldier in the hospital. The local military commander offered an explanation.
Por causa desse temporal que caiu em Varginha, existe lá um senhor anão, ele é anão baixo, ele é bem desfigurado, ele é retardado mentalmente. E por causa dessa chuva ele havia se machucado muito, né? Porque não tinha como fugir da chuva e ele estava próximo a esse terreno baldio, onde tá essas duas meninas dizem terem visto essa criança. Porque realmente, se nós olharmos para esse senhor, ele realmente tem uma aparência que nos causa até um certo constrangimento e uma aflição, porque ele tem alguma disformidade física, né? Ele tem a pele realmente escura.
Mal, meu Deus do céu, nunca vi um negócio desse. Será que ele tem coração? Tem alguma veia? Você conseguiu?
Clearly there was something strange there. But there are a large number of strange wild animals in Brazil, and some of them are certainly not creatures with which Western researchers are familiar. It's a large country, and there are all sorts of unusual animals there that may indeed cause someone to say, my goodness, what's that?
How sure are you that they were telling the truth?
Well, for us, they're telling the truth, because what they saw there, it's not a dog, it was not a... because if you try to understand what kind of animal could look like this, you won't find it, although we have many animals in Brazil. But the oil all over the body, it was shining. The bumps on the top of the head, and also the eyes. Okay, we're talking about a humanoid. So when you're confusing with a dog or with a monkey, you could say, well, it could be a monkey, but it's almost impossible because a monkey wouldn't have that those characteristics.
One of the other interesting things about the Virginia incident is that if you look at the testimony of the girls who actually saw this creature, they did not use any sort of language indicative of a UFO or an alien event. They actually referred to the creature as, quote, the devil, unquote. And it's very important to realize that witnesses, when they report something like this, will simply dredge something up from their own belief system, their own knowledge, and particularly importantly, their own cultural background. So what we have here, I think, is clearly an incident where something was seen. But this idea that it's necessarily something to do with UFOs and aliens may only have arisen once Western UFO researchers became involved, because that's not what the original witnesses said.
A few days later, another eyewitness came forward, an English-speaking lawyer, who said she had seen the actual site where the UFO was alleged to have crashed.
I live about 20 minutes from the center of Varginha, right on the edge of the hills and forests which circles the town. It was about 2 a.m., and I was asleep when I heard a huge explosion coming from outside. It sounded like a bomb had gone off, a huge explosion. When I looked out the window, I could see this huge mass of fire and smoke coming from the hillside about 1 kilometer from my house. I really had no idea what had happened, but obviously it was that. So I called the fire department immediately in Varginha, but there was no answer, which I thought was strange. But within a few minutes, I could hear their siren, so I guess someone had already let them know. Just a few minutes later, I could see, like, three army trucks speeding up in the dirt track, which leads to where the explosions were, and then a helicopter. I remember thinking, why were the army there? And how did they get to this thing so fast? It only happened less than 5 or 6 minutes ago. kept watching as both the fire department and the army units went right to where the explosion was, but it was way too far for me to see any detail. I started to think that maybe a military plane or a helicopter crashed, and that was the explosion I heard. But I still had no idea what had happened. I remember that the police and the fire department sealed off the whole area. It was only later in the day when I heard the news about these alien things, these creatures in town, and I realized that that might have well been, probably was, the crash site. That's when it all started making sense. I mean, I couldn't see much, just fire and smoke and stuff, but something crashed out there. I can 100% confirm that.
A few weeks after the incident, one of the soldiers who was present at the crash site, Marco Eli Scheresi, died from unknown toxic poisoning. His sister Marta is convinced he was poisoned through contact with this alien creature and has been fighting to get an independent autopsy on his body.
De trabalho na polícia, certo? E fez o trajeto todinho com a criatura, né? Saiu do local, foi até o Hospital Humanitas e depois só deu baixa lá na escala dele por volta de 00h45. Só que na hora que meu irmão fez a captura lá, ele podia ter simplesmente encostado, porque certos exames que eu tenho acusa que foi contagiado por pele. Não precisava ter nenhuma infecção, nenhum machucado, certo? Então, por isso que realmente houve essa captura, sim. E meu irmão participou, sim. Porque meu irmão não tinha nada.
Bizarrely, the doctors said that an autopsy wasn't necessary and ordered the body to be buried immediately. The blood tests were made available and showed that his blood contained 8%. Of unknown toxic substances.
Somebody from inside the military police from Virginia told me, I have this tape recorded, that Marco Eli Scheresi was involved in this capture. Somehow he got closer or even touched the creature. And all of a sudden he couldn't move his arms, he couldn't feed himself. He was really bad. They took Marco Eli Scheresi to the hospital. The doctors didn't say a thing to the family. A few days later, he died.
In fact, a member of the fire brigade, who was also involved at the crash site that night, also died of toxic poisoning. And although the people of Virginia and the media demanded answers, the authorities remain silent. According to our sources, whatever was recovered from the crash site was eventually flown out of the country in an unmarked transport plane within a few days. Destination unknown. And that should have been the end of the so-called incident in Brazil, except that a few weeks later, another alien creature was reported in the town of Virginia, this time at the zoo. An old lady spotted a creature very similar to the one seen by the other witnesses.
Eu não vou afirmar que vi o ET. Eu só tinha saído no alpendre para fumar. E vi uma coisa muito feia, os olhos vermelhos, grandes esbugalhados. E a cor dele era marrom escuro, era muito feio. Animal não era, isso eu tenho certeza.
What she told us is the creature had some light coming from the eyes because the place was all dark at night. But she could see the face here, a small nose, a little slit as a mouth, only because some light was coming from the eyes of the creature, no pupils. And all of a sudden, the creature was not there anymore. She went inside the place, called her husband and said, listen, we gotta get out of here.
Of course, no one knows what she saw or what she thought she saw. But it's interesting that in the days before this sighting, several animals had died suddenly at the zoo from unknown toxic poisoning.
Muito estranho que logo após o aparecimento dessa criatura, nós estávamos com um problema dentro do zoo que em morte de animais que tinham ocorrido desde fevereiro. Tá? Eu perdi 5 animais e sem explicação nenhuma científica, porque o laudo técnico diz que morreu de não sei. E não é comum. Eu sou diretora desse zoológico há 7 anos e nunca tive um caso desse.
So had another alien creature hidden itself away in the zoo, or did Mrs. Klepf misidentify some other animal?
You've got a lot of witnesses in this case. I don't think that people are making this up. What I do think we have to check out very carefully is the possibility that we are dealing with a series of events which have been, as it were, linked together, perhaps by people who are very keen to come to particular conclusions, and that we're dealing perhaps with nothing more exciting than a series of misidentifications and people putting perhaps quite extraordinary explanations on events which may be rather mundane.
The American journalist and UFO investigator Linda Moulton Howe compiled a detailed report on the incident in Brazil. She's convinced that not only did aliens crash down in Brazil in January 1996, but that both the Brazilian and the United States government deliberately covered it up.
They know and have been covering up for at least 50 years that extraterrestrial biological entities are interacting with our planet, have access to backyards, to pastures, and to even bedrooms in the human abduction syndrome. Not wanting people to be aware of that because they're afraid of mass panic, I can understand up to a point. But everything in me says, life teaches you, knowledge gives you strength, ignorance weakens you. I think the entire planet deserves the truth. Because whatever the extraterrestrial biological entities are doing, there has to be a reason for a variety of intrusions that have been happening in Mexico and South America in a very aggressive nature. But what is it? That's what we all need to find out.
She believes that the Brazilian Roswell has far greater implications beyond Virginia, maybe even provides the key to what aliens want with our planet.
Biggest issue for me after 2 decades that haunts me to this day is what is the motive of extraterrestrial biological entities interacting with this planet. And in any given story and any given eyewitness, you can find yourself swinging, oh, it must be horrible. Oh, it is so good and spiritual, they've healed people. But the government is nervous, and you find yourself swaying. Is it good? Is it bad? Is it neutral? Is it benign? Is it, what is it? And I've begun to realize that probably the most dangerous thing that any of us could do is try to box it in any category, because right now, I don't know that that's possible, not from a human point of view. My own personal feeling at the year 1997, and that's what it falls into a category, because I can't prove any of this. But it's a feeling or a growing sense that the complexity, the profound level of complexity of what we are dealing with, a non-human intelligence that appears, as government insiders have told me, a million years in advance in technological achievement than we are, that's incomprehensible. What they're able to do with gravity, with electromagnetic spectra, it's beyond my ability to comprehend or anybody's ability.
Intriguingly, the Brazilian Roswell, as it's become known, is not the only close encounter of the fourth kind that's been reported. There are dozens of detailed files, many of which remain classified, containing eyewitness reports and even photos of alleged alien creatures.
I'm convinced beyond doubt that we have recovered aircraft, alien vehicles, that we have made contact with aliens, that we are communicating with them in some way or form, and that we have vehicles and bodies in preservation.
I take a clear-cut, unambiguous stand. One, the evidence is overwhelming that planet Earth is being visited by intelligently controlled extraterrestrial spacecraft. In other words, some UFOs, underline the some 18 times, are extraterrestrial spacecraft. Most are not, I don't care about those. Secondly, we're dealing with a cosmic Watergate. That means that some few people within the governments of the United States, Canada, Britain, and undoubtedly other countries have known since July 1947 when at least two crashed flying saucers and several alien bodies were recovered in New Mexico, that indeed some UFOs are extraterrestrial spacecraft. Three, none of the arguments made against the first two conclusions by a very small but very noisy group of negativists, as I call them, the debunkers, stand up under careful scrutiny.
I think that undeniably and unquestionably, we have been and are being visited by extraterrestrials, but quite what their motives are and quite what's going on, the jury's still out on that one. We need to know, though.
Based on 25 years or so of research and history and sighting analysis, doing case investigations, film photography, still photography, video, and so on, I've concluded that they are here, whoever they are, wherever they came from, whatever they're doing. Other intelligences are messing around on our planet. And I guess it's up to society to realize that and come up with some sort of a response before it's too late.
I think the major reason for reticence to discuss this subject publicly and for the extremely high level of secrecy is embarrassment. I don't think it's so much that they think the public is going to panic, rather that they, the officials in charge of this information, are going to look rather impotent were it known that there are extraterrestrials invading our airspace against whom we have inadequate defense.
What really happened in Virginia is still a mystery. On one hand, there are dozens of reliable witnesses, both civilian and military, who swear blindly that they saw alien creatures that night. There's an eyewitness who saw the crash site in flames, and there's a soldier who claims to have guarded the creature inside the hospital. On the other hand, the Brazilian military and fire department deny anything happened and that the witnesses are just misidentified dwarves.
I'm pleased to see that, partly because of Roswell as a precedent, that people are taking such an event seriously. Is this perhaps, I don't know of any previous cases where beings like this were seen before, maybe this is a new step in what's going on.
I think we're just having the biggest opportunity to prove that the mankind had some contact with alien creatures. The Roswell incident is a very important one, but it happened 50 years ago. This is recent. We have a lot of information from military sources, civilian sources. I mean fresh information. So I think this is going to be a very important situation where we can prove that alien beings had really visited our planet.
We already know the names of the people involved. We know the details of the operation of capture, of transportation, the creatures, everything. They can't hide much from us.
I think one must remember that witnesses are fallible. People make mistakes, people misidentify things, particularly if they see them under unusual conditions. So always, I would say to people, look for the prosaic explanations first. look for the misidentification of some sort of military exercise going on. Look perhaps for the idea that you might have had some space debris re-entering the Earth's atmosphere, giving rise to quite a spectacular display. Consider again the entity report that you might simply be dealing with some wild animal, startled and perhaps again seen by people that weren't particularly used to seeing this sort of creature. There are many, many things which perhaps individually wouldn't have given rise to this great incident, but when perhaps just taken together led to an extraordinary series of coincidences which frankly gave us a situation where people have got things wrong.
In this documentary, you will see miraculous UFO footage that has been authenticated by top UFO.
The documentary featured an extensive summary of the footage, the canisters containing the footage, an expert analysis from the likes of Stanton Friedman. One film expert noted in the documentary that the footage came in an old Soviet canister that had information labeled on it that was consistent with info written directly on the film reel. The numbers on the film's header matched the canisters they came. The header of the film had the crest of the KGB on it, and the term for TOP secret is shown in the first few seconds of this footage and image to the right. Having real-looking alien footage is one thing, but including the original film reel canisters means you are extremely close to proving 100% authenticity. This is something that has traditionally lacked in other more popular alien videos, such as the widely known Alien Autopsy or the Alien Interview videos. 3. Several KGB documents. In the documentary, several KGB documents are produced to prove the film is authentic, along with credible testimony from a former Soviet KGB operative who claims to know about the event. At first, everyone believed that those debris were part of some novelty aircraft manufactured in the United States or England, said Pavel Klimchinkov, a former KGB operative, but having done some measurements material analysis, we came to the conclusion that none of the domestic or foreign manufacturers known to us could have produced this apparatus, at least not in the conditions existing on this planet. Along with Pavel's testimony, authentic KGB top secret documents were obtained by the filmmakers, allegedly costing them $10,000. The documents described in detail a crash site recovery operation of a disc-shaped object and organic remains. Based on the credible testimony, KGB documents, expert film analysis, and the general good feeling one gets when watching this interesting crash site video, it is safe to assume that this film indeed may be authentic. What about the autopsy? This footage will be posted in our second part article, along with thoughts and analysis, actors, training exercises, skepticism. Some have put forth the argument that an American production crew filmed the footage in March 1998. These claims are put forth on websites claiming to know the truth about this footage. To date, they have failed to show even one current photo of any of the soldiers in the film, nor any statements from the actors that they were indeed only actors in this film. This should be easy to obtain if the footage was recently filmed. Some have put forth the argument that an American production crew filmed the footage in March 1998. These claims are put forth on websites claiming to know the truth about this footage. To date, they have failed to show even one current photo of any of the soldiers in the film, nor any statements from the actors that they were indeed only actors in this film. This should be easy to obtain if the footage was recently filmed. Another theory suggests the film was a training exercise. Yet no one has produced witnesses verifying this claim. One skeptical viewpoint suggests that the object's thickness is far too small to support any would-be alien pilot. The craft's outer edge, as seen on the image, is only 12 to 36 inches. However, it is not necessarily indicative of the overall thickness of the craft. The image was taken from the only part in the video sequence where the craft's edge is visible, and since the camera never goes behind, there is no way to tell how much depth the craft may have on the other side. Additionally, if you consider the side facing us may be actually be the bottom, we can easily see that this craft can easily fit the traditional flying saucer shape as demonstrated by the below images. In this documentary, they claim that, since they only were able to acquire 4 canisters of film, more film footage of this incident is available, such as the entire digging, cleanup, and inside the craft investigation. To this date, almost a decade after it went public, No other videos have surfaced. A UFO crash site allegedly filmed by the Russian KGB in March of 1969 in the Sverdlovsk region of Russia. The footage was later obtained by documentary filmmakers who then published the movie, The Secret KGB UFO Files. A film expert noted in the documentary that the film came in an old Soviet film can and the numbers on the film's header match the cans they came in. The header of the film has the crest of the KGB on it and the term for TOP secret. An autopsy of the alleged pilot of the UFO is seen in the documentary film. Soviet doctors examined the burned torso of the entity and it is revealed that the three doctors died 1 week later, all from cerebral hemorrhages. Death certificates are presented as proof. Several KGB documents are produced to prove the film is authentic. Some have put forth the argument that an American production crew filmed the footage in March 1998. These claims are put forth on websites claiming to know the truth about this footage. To date, they have failed to show even one current photo of any of the soldiers in the film, nor any statements from the actors that they were indeed only actors in this film. This should be easy to obtain if the footage was recently filmed. Another theory suggests the film was a training exercise. Yet no one has produced witnesses verifying this claim. UFO aliens may have helped build pyramids of Giza, says Cairo University archaeologist. Head of the Cairo University Archaeology Department, Dr. Ela Shaheen, in December 2010 had told an audience that there might be truth to the theory that aliens helped the ancient Egyptians build the oldest of pyramids, the Pyramids of Giza. On being further questioned by Mr. Marek Novak, a delegate from Poland, as to whether the pyramid might still contain alien technology or even the UFO with its structure, Dr. Shaheen was vague and replied, "I cannot confirm or deny this, but there is something inside the pyramid that is not of this world." Delegates to the Conference on Ancient Egyptian Architecture were left shocked. However, Dr. Shaheen had refused to comment further or elaborate on his UFO and alien-related statements. Down below is 90s The Secret KGB UFO Files documentary, that deals with the fact that Russian had already discovered the tomb of alien humanoid in Egypt and something is beneath the pyramid. The Secret KGB UFO Files documentary, interestingly supporting the head of the Cairo University Archaeology Department, Dr. Ela Shaheen, claim as well. Actually, ancient Egyptian writings very often talk of beings from the sky opening and bright lights coming down to teach them technology and give them wisdom. Many pictures and symbols resemble UFOs and aliens. Possibly aliens built the Great Pyramid. And these solid long-lasting construction techniques were adopted by the Egyptians. Ancient Egyptian legends tell of Tepzepi, or the first time. This is described as an age when sky gods came down to earth and raised the land from mud and water. They supposedly flew through the air in flying boats and brought laws and wisdom to man through a royal line of pharaohs. And of course, this was all thrown out the window when Christianity came along. Keep in mind that the gods were the one and only religion that there was. No other conflicting beliefs? Why? Well, because it was fact, not faith. The modern church would have you believe that it's just a myth. But you have to ask yourself, on the edge of Occam's razor, what truly indeed is more likely? There has always been the question. How did the Egyptians feed and care for the 100,000 slaves that it would have taken to build the ancient structures like that of the pyramids in Egypt? One minute it is a very backwards country and almost overnight a highly advanced and technological culture sprung into existence. We now have the answer to that very question and evidence that the Egyptians had help, extraterrestrial help at that, thanks to Russia, the KGB, and a top secret project called Project Isis. Astrophysicist, neurologist and science advisor in advanced propulsion system gained access to the files of Project Isis. This was a top-secret project brought about by KBG concerning the discovery of the tomb of the visitor in 1961, up until Sci-Fi purchased this exclusive footage from an agent of the Russian mafia. It had never been seen outside the top-secret facilities of the KGB. Sci-Fi showed it one time on television, and as it stands today, no evidence of this film or the project is available. Except what we have copies of here given to us by a client that had taped the original show. This video is a powerful documentary with actual footage filmed by the KGB and verified by specialists in the field. authentic film footage. If we can somehow bring attention back on Project Isis and prove it out, it will change the history of the beginning of the civilization of man. During the Cold War, Nikita Khrushchev was determined to show the world that communism was superior over the democracy. As he realized that it would be too costly to compete with the US in the space race, Khrushchev chose to go the other route. Having over 300,000 agents in the secret police and espionage organizations, he focused most of this resource on alternative science, such as paranormal phenomena, psotromedic weapons, biogenerators and mind-altering machines. 1920s, during the Stalinist regime, a dark room was created where the KGB conducted psotronic weapons research on prisoners sentenced to die in political dissidence. After 1936, these files were transferred to the secret archives of the KGB, continuing on with their paranormal research. Khrushchev achieved great success with his biogenerators and machines to alter human minds, which worried, naturally, the United States, knowing that the Soviet Union was there to conquer and overthrow Russia, being that its borders surrounded the largest landmass of the world, had the largest amount of UFO sightings. If they could capture one of these flying objects and reverse engineer it, they could have the greatest advanced aeronautical designs. They got lucky in January 1986 when a spacecraft crashed in Dalgorsk but remained intact. The craft was back-engineered and the process was quite successful. But to achieve the most superior advancement in global domination, they went in search for something that was only a rumor or legend. The Chamber of Knowledge in Egypt. If the legends were true, storehouse of knowledge left behind by ancient visitors from outer space was concealed in the Great Pyramid. A team of archaeologists were composed of Egyptologists from the Russian Soviet Academy of Science, was sent to Egypt. The fearing that the CIA would learn of this expedition, the Kremlin operated with complete secrecy. By the late 1950s, Egypt accounted for 43% of all the Soviet aid for Third World nations. When they started the ISIS project, the Soviet military personnel in Egypt was estimated over 20,000. The heavy military presence was used to disguise the efforts of the mission scientists headquartered in Cairo. They would operate under the guise of Arab peasants or Russian officers. To speed things up, in 1959 the KGB recruited professional informationalists to wiretap Egyptian officials. This paid off in July 24, 1960 when a conversation was recorded that would then change myth into reality. The official had been given a call that two Bedouin had stumbled upon the tomb of the visitor. The Bedouin were in the hospital and kept repeating, "The visitor God." At this moment in time, Project Isis became top priority and all efforts were made to immediately follow up by having the Bedouin show them where they had found this tomb. SEIFI was able to purchase several documents and film footage as to the KGB documentations of their findings. Taken out of Egypt and brought to the secret facility of the KGB was this memo to high-ranking KGB official. "My agents had secured the notes of one of the scientists working on the tomb of the visitor findings. Another was the inventory of contents taken from the tomb as follows. Location of finding. Undisclosed. 15 crates of relics, 1 partially mummified body, 1 stone sarcophagus, 8 hieroglyphic samples." Old report from a project scientist that was one of the first to enter the tomb. "During the inspection of the wall segment, we noted that a strange magnet repulsive force seemed to be emanating from the rock. We were unable to find any scientific explanation." Cryptologist report. "Partial decoded message on tomb wall indicating a prophecy of the return of the winged gods." The Kremlin took the cryptologist report very seriously. KGB was ordered to determine target locations, e.g. planets, stars, galaxies. They had to duplicate the stars as they would have been over Giza thousands of years ago. They finally found it, in the stars and constellation of Orion during the year 10,500 BC. Although it was possible that the builders could have been working off plans of a time before the pyramids was constructed, this was proven not to be the case. Metal and synthetic materials of tomb were determined to be of unknown origin and the tomb was carbon dated, giving it a dating of 10,500 BC, meaning the pyramid had to have been made at 10,500 BC. Kins of film were purchased by SEIFI through the Russian Mafia agent, which originally came from the maximum security archives of the KGB. These kins contain film of KGB filming the process of the tomb and sarcophagus being opened. SEIFI had this film analyzed before purchasing by experts in this field. Finding no evidence of fraud, SEIFI purchased kins of film. The documentary is in black and white, showing soldiers entering the tomb without gas masks. As they opened the sarcophagus, you can see toxic fumes escaping and the reaction of the soldiers as they were being affected. It also shows the mummy contained inside. The film shows the soldiers leaving the tomb fast, and then a chemical warfare specialist team comes in with protective clothing. There is talk from one that was there in the tomb that the energy inside during the first days of exploration was very, very high. They also had a team of psychics go in and do some special readings of the tomb. It later goes on to show the KGB and Bedouin loading trucks with crates to be shipped back to Russia. According to KGB documents, researchers began to wonder if the pyramid was designed for one particular purpose. They thought it was possibly a machine, being that it was designed like a three-dimensional triangular depiction of a hemisphere. Their thoughts were there must have been a reason why it was designed for resonating with the planet. Their thoughts went to a prism, and that the pyramids have powers to alter the cosmic rays, that the pyramids are huge prisms capable of concentrating energy, capturing light from the stars, which would initiate a process which would turn the pyramid into an interstellar transmitter. The three pyramids and SPHNIX could be integral parts of an immense machine designed by alien engineers, linked by a master control mechanism inside the Great Pyramids. They noted that the passageway goes to main chamber, and above the sarcophagus was a tunneled star shaft. They reasoned that when a specific star alignment occurs, a streak of energy goes down the shaft. Scientists speculated that the radiant energy hitting the sarcophagus could initiate something similar to a cold fusion reaction. The prism structure of the pyramid would then magnify and transfer to the corresponding pyramids. A unified beam of energy could erupt, creating a cosmic beacon used by alien starship for future navigation. According to ancient legends all around the world, they all have the same thing in common. The visitors were like men, but more like gods. They were giants. They traveled among the stars. They brought us the knowledge. Legends of the first emperors of China were called the Sons of Heaven and made the first pyramids of China. Mexico and Yucatan have similar legends. Starwalkers can be found throughout Egyptian texts and S. American folklore. The visitors are described as the giants, man/gods, giants or titans. And it seems all cultures may be traced to a single parent civilization. Could it be E.T.? Later on in the documentary, it shows them working on the mummy, attempting to give it a face and identity. A computer projection of the mummy was made as it laid in the sarcophagus. Experts that were there to observe the fluorescent reconstruction of the face described to SEIFI that if they had not been there themselves, they would not have believed what the face revealed after reconstruction. When skull and face was completed, it showed a humanoid type, large cranium, large eyes, small chin, small teeth, but not Earth humanoid, but some being that had to have been extraterrestrial. Later, using underground radar technology, the KBG found a passageway under the tomb of the visitor. Directly below was a large chamber. They believed they found the chamber of knowledge, but was afraid to open the tomb, thinking it could be a Trojan horse, capable of blowing up the entire planet. They decided to seal the tomb, wipe away the location of the tomb, and close the project. It seemed, however, that all were affected by the discovery. Some had personality changes. Some disappeared entirely, others committed suicide, and others no longer could support their old religious beliefs. The first official report of sightings, that we are aware of, was by King Tutankhamun about 3,400 years ago. Sightings continued through the ages. Sightings seemed to pick up with man mastered the skies. But when we conquered the inner workings of the atom, the aliens of Orion stepped up their observation with an explosion of UFO sightings that continue up to the present. UFO abduction reports began to sweep around the world in the early 60s. A pattern was developing with nearly all abductees reporting physical examinations, insertion of objects and artificial inseminations. Many women abductees believed they were being impregnated to give birth to alien hybrids. In the last decade, reports such as these have risen dramatically. It may be highly likely that the genetic colonization program that started back in the ancient times has resumed. The question was asked, could they be cloning themselves by implanting their alien genes into human DNA? Are humans being transformed into an alien species through genetic engineering? The ancient Egyptians have always said that our DNA came from the heavens and that someday they would return. Did the KGB discover the truth in the Chamber of Knowledge about the true agenda of the IT? And what was discovered on the wall of the tomb of the visitor prophesies that they would return. But when? Secrets cannot be contained. Not even KGB secrets. A group of scientists, computer programs, doctors, etc. shortly after the discovery of the tomb of the visitor, came together to discuss the possibilities of this discovery. They fully believed that the visitor was none other than Osiris, the alien king. Thus they gave themselves the name, the Followers, based off the followers of Horus in the Egyptian Book of the Dead. According to Egyptian beliefs, a family of gods came from the stars to Egypt. They were the ones that gave the people of Egypt the knowledge and wisdom. Later they left Earth back to their star homes, except for Osiris. He stayed and taught the followers. It was their duty to protect and keep the ancient knowledge he gave them until his return. The Egyptians were astronomers and fully understood that the stars were the map to the great god Osiris and the afterlife. Modern followers would secretly come together in their homes to discuss the possibility of the return of Osiris. They believed that the second coming of Osiris would herald a new age for mankind. They believed that when the tomb was discovered and the seal was broken, a signal was transmitted to the visitors. They calculated and estimated the time it would take for the electromagnetic signal to reach the constellation of Orion. They figured that they could return no earlier than April 23, 1985. With that time frame in mind, the group left Russia and took off to Egypt. Never to return. The only remains left behind of their meeting with the visitors was a newspaper clippage found in the KGB archives of a group of tourists disappearing in the middle of the night in Egypt, 1985. And one home movie project with film. This film showed the group in front of the pyramid at night. It shows a light appearing in the sky, the group dropping to their knees in prayer, the light becoming brighter and then nothingness. A daughter of parents that were part of this group was shown the home video by the SEIFI team, of which she recognized her parents and burst into tears.
Did anyone happen to see a documentary on Sci-Fi called Secret KGB UFO Files? I happened to catch this yesterday and while I'm leaning to the side of skepticism, I have to admit that it was intriguing. Basically, the story goes. In the early 60s, the KGB discovered a tomb at the Giza Plateau containing an Eva. Luckily, there was film footage, The grainy film contained footage of archaeologists dressed in KGB gear opening the tomb of what was thought to be an ancient Egyptian king. When they do, toxic smoke overcomes one of them and the other two run out. It is later learned that the body isn't human. The footage looked as if it had been produced to look old. Also, included were shots of psychics levitating in the tomb. One thing that caught my attention is the archaeologist that was supposed to have been claimed by the toxic smoke was later helping move crates of evidence down some stairs. Despite the curious film footage, the documentary was very interesting and had me glued from the jump. For decades, American agencies have stockpiled information on UFOs. So did their counterparts behind the Iron Curtain, soldiers, scientists and spies all paint a disturbing picture of the KGB's secret campaign. Is this the stunning proof that the Soviets recovered something not from this Earth? When US researchers began looking into just how much the Soviet government knew about UFOs and extraterrestrial visitation, They were not surprised to learn that the Russians took the subject very seriously. What they didn't expect was evidence of ancient alien visitation, paranormal properties associated with related artifacts, and most shocking of all, of a mass abduction in 1985, among the piles of materials obtained from former Soviet spies. Some extremely puzzling and disturbing documents and film footage surfaced confirming rumors, which had been circulating for decades. In the late 1950s and 60s, the Russians became very interested in a number of unusual and newly discovered archaeological sites in Egypt by interpreting ancient symbols. One of those sites was believed to contain the remains of a life form not from Earth. Startling top-secret film footage, never before seen outside the Kremlin, confirms the Soviet mission to recover and analyze these remains. Join host Roger Moore in an exclusive investigation into one of the most compelling events of our time.